Yay! GutCheck's back! Woo! Welcome, everyone. My name is the Colonist, and we are finally finishing up the first round today. After months and months and months of doing nothing, we're finally back on track. We're going to get you some GutCheck episodes, and we're finally finishing the first round. We are having our last two matches in the first round today, right now. And we're also going to get the first match in the second round as well. So this is going to be great. I actually have recorded, I know, all the way up till, I think, we finished the second round before Harvest Havoc. I think we actually are going to be done with the second round by Harvest Havoc. Yeah, because Episode 7's got four round two matches. Episode 8 has got, I guess, the final three to make it. So we finished round two. So we're going to be done with round two by the time that Harvest Havoc happens. Hopefully it will be a little bit easier to do because the matches are actually way shorter in round two than they are in round one, surprisingly enough. But here comes the first match, which is Alex Page versus... Oh, I don't have my notebook. Well, here comes Alex Page. I'm going to actually find my notebook. Pardon me for one moment. Son of a bitch. Okay. Alright, here we go. We have Alex Page, who is a member of Trevolution, taking on... wait a minute, I could just look up the tournament on the laptop. Ha 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 ha. Where is he? Alex Page versus Nathan Von Schrader, who is part of... also Trevolution. This is a Trevolution-only match coming up right here. So... these two men, which means Trevolution is guaranteed at least one more spot in the tournament, moving into round two. All of the matches in round two are hardcore matches, which means we're going to have our work cut out for us in that endeavor, but it's going to be fun. We're going to have a good time, and, you know, I've been really excited to get back into GutCheck, because I do like the idea of original talent. Despite what you've been seeing right now, no, I have not gotten to putting everyone's entrances in, but I'm thinking that I'm going to do that like after the tournament's over, because as it stands right now, I really don't think it's inherently necessary. I'm sorry, I moved back for a second because I need to put my phone in the charger, but I don't think it's inherently necessary to give them all entrances at the moment. I mean, I will, but I really want to be focused more on... I mean, Redemption is really getting their stuff together, but they, you know, they're still recruiting a roster, if you will. Despite how star-studded it is, there is a lot of creation, at least so I've been told, that goes into that. Here comes Nathan Von Schrader, who also has his own entrance. So this is kind of a rarity than what we're seeing right here, where these two both have their own entrance, but I'm sure you're probably wondering why it is that I have a couple people with entrances and the majority of people not. And the easiest answer is, I used to have like a little league that I never aired or did anything like a show about or stuff like that. And I had only maybe like 10 or 12 people in it. And both Alex Page and Nathan Von Schrader were part of that already previously created group of people that just conveniently would fit into the grand scheme of CIW GutCheck. So, you know, people like Mr. Vix, Chesterfield, the Colonial Clone, Ryan Wendell, Daryl McEwen, all those people, they were already in the game before I made and filled in the rest of the roster. So, but as it stands, fear not, because we are actually going to do everybody's entrances. I just haven't really gotten around to it. I haven't had the time, but I think part of this big overhaul that I'm doing, because this is the second show of 10 that I'm doing between now and the October 3rd pay-per-view, Harvest Havoc, which we have not determined where we are yet, but we're here in the Gut Check zone, I guess, or the Gut Check arena, if you will, which we have in a nice little cushy spot in Connecticut. I'm not going to say where, or maybe I will. I don't know, I haven't decided yet. But this, we have Connecticut, this is where people go to train. And Alex Page and Nathan Von Schrader starting out this match. And Schrader going for a quick roll-up, trying to steal a victory here. Cover two, and no, not enough this time. And this is only round one. These are the last two matches of round one, so we've got something good going on here. And hopefully as the time progresses and as the feud progresses... Oh, a nice cross-arm breaker there by Nathan Von Schrader, who decides not to exploit the referee's count. Nathan Von Schrader, a native German, is a huge beer connoisseur. You'd be amazed how much he knows about beer. He's actually been able to list... There's a chart that I actually found in a magazine that he already knew. He could tell you, piece by piece, what constitutes an ale from a lager. Which, there's this whole thing about that. There's actually these, like, two separate strains, and then there's a whole bunch of stuff that branches out. It's really actually a cool graph. But Nathan Von Schrader, he knows that stuff off memory. And it's really impressive, but I love talking to him because, like, he could have easily dominated Beer Fest. The whole movie. Here comes a leg attack. Take a drink. And Trevor's got to be pretty happy in this instance because he's already moving on to the second round. He's guaranteed got a second round. I believe he actually already has... he's already in the second round because him made it to the second round. But I believe that's the only character of his that he's got. Yes. I am correct, I'm pretty sure, because Evan Hunter, Golden Mask, both of them were eliminated in the first round. So let me give some updates here. The Shadow has Magma, Abracadabra, and Buzz in the second round. He has three people on his team. The NWO Shark Tank, my team, has the Colonial Clone. I believe that is my only member, is the Colonial Clone, although I do have another one coming up soon, because Chester Field is set to be in action later on, so we are going to see him later on tonight. The Abusement Park, Jack Anderson's team, has Eclipse, who is in... Oh, I'm sorry, I have Tex. Tex made it. Tex beat James Marks in the first round, so he's moving on. So it's myself and Tex. The Eclipse made it in. Let's see. Default was eliminated by Daryl McEwen in a great match. Optimus Composite's still in. That Guy is still in. And the Marine was eliminated. Marine got eliminated by his own partner, Optimus Composite. So... The Abusement Park has three guys still in. So it's the same as the Shadow. Joshua Campbell's team, taking a look. Zephyr is still in. Saw is still in, I believe. Yep. Chromatron was eliminated. Daryl McEwen is still in. And Galen Starr was eliminated. So Joshua Campbell also has three men. And Magnitude has Valiente, the Mother Clucker, and potentially Oli Cannoli if he can beat out Chester Field later on tonight. So we'll have to see how that goes. So far, it seems like Trivolution with one is the lowest, the men with the fewest amount of athletes in the second round. Only next to me, who has two in, but could potentially have three, pending I get a win tonight. So we'll see what Chesterfield does, and we'll see that match. That match is coming up a little later, and that is the last match of the first round that you will be seeing. And now back to this match, and a double powerbomb. Beautiful strength by Nathan Von Schrader. But will that be enough to catapult him into the second round? And I think Alex Page has probably an equal amount of strength, at least... If one is judging by looks and by stature, it certainly looks like Alex Page has definitely got the edge. Or at least in an equal measure. But Nathan Von Schrader is so far pretty well dominating this match. Nice side slam there. Both of these guys would love nothing more and to cement themselves into the second round. Both fighting for Trevolution. So this is an interesting dynamic because really what it boils down to is who wants that CIW GutCheck Championship more. And the fact that they had to face each other in the first round, it's interesting because, you know, obviously there's a level of respect. A springboard by Schrader, and completely overshot Alex Page. Page went for a fist into the ground and definitely connected with the blacktop. And now Von Schrader, nice swinging neck breaker. And Von Schrader and Alex Page doing everything they can to make themselves the champion, which is what it's all about, is being the first CIW GutCheck champion, which we will crown eventually. I'm guessing that November, we're finally going to finish this. Because we do have the second round already completed, at least the film-wise, I haven't done the commentary for it yet, but we've got that coming up, so we don't really have to worry about that. So I'm guessing that we'll probably get through the third round, which because we're down to eight men, who I'm not going to spoil it, but when we're down to eight, those matches should be pretty quick, I would guess. So we got four matches there, and then the semis, and then the finals. So we'll be able to get GutCheck done probably if we're looking at three matches apiece. Episode 9, Episode 10 could be those two rounds easily. But what would be interesting is that would also require that one man would have to wrestle twice in one night. So we'll have to see how that works out. We'll have to see how it plays out. But you never know. By GutCheck 10, we will have the finals of the tournament set up, and they will probably be competing in a pay-per-view, which I think is only fair. I think it's only fair if the GutCheck got a spot in the pay-per-view for the actual championship. So kind of what we did with the tag team, which we're going to be doing more with the tag team. So rest assured, we're not going to give up on the tag team division. We're just kind of waiting until we actually get this tournament done, because it has been so long since we started this tournament, and I'm sick of doing it, as I'm sure you've guessed. I'm not saying I'm sick of doing this commentary and doing GutCheck, but like, you start a tournament and then it just takes so long to finish, and you're just like, yes, we're done, thank God. So I'm excited for the finals, even though we're still in the first round here, but give it a couple weeks. By the time November hits, November pay-per-view comes along, we will have a GutCheck champion, and we can actually start moving forward with fun stuff, which we haven't really been able to do yet. Nice drop toehold by Nathan Von Schrader, who has really been probably been the stronger of the two men in this match, has had more moves, has taken advantage more of his spots. When Alex Page tried to leave the ring smartly, but Von Schrader caught him with what looks like is going to be, oh God, what is this? Good Lord. And Von Schrader with the atomic bomb, for lack of a better name of it, but what a shot that was. The cover on Page, and it's over. And so Nathan Von Schrader punches his ticket into the next round. But will it be enough to move him forward into the third round in a hardcore match, who Nathan Von Schrader will be facing that guy in the second round? So we'll be anticipating that matchup, as we will all the other matchups. But your winner, Nathan Von Schrader, in an excellent showing, if I do say so myself. And I would have to say that he has proven his worth to make it into the second round, a well-earned victory by our resident German. And with that said, we are going to move on to our final match of the first round, finally making some forward progress, which is what this is all about. It's all about making that forward progress, making sure that everything we do is worth watching, and we're finally getting there. So with that said, let's move on. Now, Chester, holy cow. Chester looks like he's got fangs. Chester, an animated live teddy bear, facing Jersey Shore's own Ole Canole. And he makes sure that he is informing you about just how much that he loves the Jersey Shore. He's not Robbie E. He's no Ronnie. But he's from the Jersey Shore. He just happens to be from there. You know, he's not part of the culture, if you will. But that's not to say that he wouldn't take part in it if it were around, bro. But in any event, this is the final match of the first round. Gotta say, pretty happy about that. So I'm trying to come up with your Al Snow Tweet of the Day quickly. Al Snow. And I do love me some Al Snow. No matter what, I still love Al Snow's tweets. Even though he's kind of like, half the time that I read his tweet, which I don't even read until I actually do this, like until I actually get to this point. And a lot of the time, I'm trying to, oh, here we go. See, because it's difficult because he does a lot of retweets. And he's, yes, before I get to that, he does a lot of retweets and he does this stuff. And then he does, like, some of these, like, jokes, which are, some of them are funny. And some of them are just like, what are you even doing, Al Snow? Like, how did you get to where you are? Which, where even are you? I think he might be part of TNA? Maybe? I don't know. I mean, being part of TNA is kind of like not having a job. Because, like think about Van Damme. Van Damme went to TNA for like 3 years, and then he left to come back to WWE, and everyone was like, where were you? Like nobody cared. I think it's funny, it's sad. It's also sad, because TNA used to be something good, and then they just totally ruined it. The Ole Canole, who self-proclaimed People's Champ, whether that is true or not is yet. Look at how string beanie he is. Look how thin he is. Look, he's got the smallest waistline I think I've seen of any wrestler ever. He makes Colin Delaney look like a fat mother. But, yeah, Colin Delaney. He was around at a time. And if you don't know who Colin Delaney is, nobody blames you for not knowing who Colin Delaney is. But feel free to go look him up. Because it might put a smile on your face. Or it won't. It'll make you feel bad. I don't know. Either one is somewhat applicable to me. But anyway, last match of the first round, this is closing it out. And will it be Magnitude with 3 into the second round, or will it be the NWO, myself, making their way into the second round with 3 men? Only time will tell. And that is what we do these matches for. That's why we have these matches in place. And that is the joy of a tournament, is that you get to see the skill level and the talent level, and which teams will go where. And I talked to Magnitude the other day. He didn't even know he had a team. And he won the tag titles. He's like, oh, I won the tag titles? Great. Let's go, boys. And then, like, okay. So he didn't even know he had a team. But he has one nonetheless. And Ole Canole very girlishly leaving the ring. Chester's just standing there like, come on, what are we doing? Can we fight? And now Ole Canole just avoiding Chesterfield, look at that, leaving the ring again. I guess just not in the mood to fight, and comes back in the ring. And, Ole Canole, what are you doing? Stop this, just fight him. Chester's just standing there like, he's got to come back in. What is happening? What is even happening? So Ole Canole comes back in the ring. No, stop it! Just get back in the ring, fight each other, damn it! Oh, man. And Chester now finally catching up with Ole Canole on the outside. So after the very first set of, like, 2 minutes of nothing, we finally get a leg lock on the outside. This is the last match of the first round. Don't make me regret putting you two last. You guys were supposed to have the best match of anybody. Ole Canole! Stop it! And a left jab, and Chester leaves the ring. Fight each other! This isn't supposed to be this bad! Oh my god! And now a head jab, and now a wrist lock by Ole Canole. And okay, now we actually might be starting to see stuff that matters here. And a headlock into a hammer lock. Nice bit of chain wrestling there by Canole and a bulldog. Oh, that was funny. That was a solid 2 minutes of nothing happening. But good stuff regardless. Punch to the back. Chester! Come on, dude. And this isn't even a game of cat and mouse. This is a game of just, I'm going to run away from you. Then I'm going to try and fight you, and you're going to run away from me. So, I don't know what that was all about. And now we finally saw a nice crucifix head scissors. And now Chesterfield going for a Boston Crab, almost a high-angled Boston Crab. Nicely done, but Canole gets out of it and a thumb to the eye. Not going to see that in any official rule book, but doesn't seem like Cannoli's too concerned about that. And Cannoli now with a nice scoop slam, taking down NWO's resident cruiserweight, Chester Field, who is the reincarnation of a live teddy bear, Ted style. But instead of being a Boston loudmouth who smokes pot and does crazy stuff, he decided to become a professional wrestler, which I think is admirable, and a nice hip toss. Nice high-angled hip toss, if you will. And Chester Field, he's got the accolades, I'm sure, but he's going to depend on whether he wins tonight. The cover 1-2, and Cannoli kicks out. And what a demoralizing loss this would be to Ole Cannoli if he in fact lost to a teddy bear. But what a win this would be for Chester Field if he in fact did pull off the victory here in a nice clothesline. And now Chester Field still going after it, but a nice counter by Cannoli. And neither one of these guys able to get this going the way they want to. Nice West Coast pop style. Cover, is it over here? And Cannoli kicks out just at the nick of time. 2.5, if you will. And both these men, part of the lighter portion of our division. Beautiful neck breaker. And for a cruiserweight, Chester's pretty versed in technical ability, it seems. And now he's going to just... And as soon as I say that, just punching. Just fully punching. And a rear naked choke. And so I guess it started out with some physical attacks, but went right back to that technical assertion that he has used to gain the advantage so far over Cannoli. But Cannoli is not going to stop in his own right. He knows that this is part of winning. This is all about the ultimate prize. And I'm sure Chester knows that too. That this is for the GutCheck Championship. Teams' allegiances aside, there's much more to it than that for these two young men. Or bear. And they are going to do whatever they can to cement themselves into the next round. And to make it into the hardcore round. And we're probably not going to see a whole lot of technical ability there. But a nice, beautiful, almost a chicken wing variation maneuver. And nicely done by Cannoli. And Chester Field reeling from that, but Field not going to quit. And referee Luke Goss, as always, assigned to this contest. Ole Cannoli went for a bitch slap. And was off the mark. And now a hip toss of Chester's own. And down goes Cannoli. Chester Field looking to take the advantage of his somewhat weakened opponent. But neither one of these guys. Oh, and looks like the lights are kind of flickering in and out. But now, oh, nice backbreaker there. Shades of the legend killer Randy Orton. Not the Viper, even though the Viper used it. Or the Apex Predator. No, legend killer Randy Orton. And Chester Field now, and a drop toe hold, taking advantage of Cannoli's speed by utilizing Chester's own. But Cannoli, coming right back with another thumb to the eye, is going to need cataracts, apparently. And now a counter by Chester Field. And what is Chester going to do? Nothing, apparently, as... Ole Cannoli now bringing him to the corner. Looks like he's going to rain some close fist punches without the barbecue sauce. Which is okay, because, you know, here's a fun fact about me. The Colonist is not a huge fan of ketchup. Don't know why. I like it with fries. But on a burger? Eh. Even barbecue sauce, I'm kind of like, eh, about it. Depends on what I'm eating it with. And Chester Field goes for the spear, called the Spinal Tap. And, wow, Chester Field, what a shot that was. Chester should really go for a cover here, but Cannoli gets up before that opportunity. And nice sweep leg takedown. Another good technical maneuver. And it's kind of refreshing to see that a teddy bear who wanted to be a professional wrestler took to more the technical aspect than more the sensationalist wrestling that we've seen nowadays, where it's all about the pops that you get, the cheap pops and the cheap moves, the spots. It's all about spot picking. And you know what? I'm going to go on a side tangent here, because I'm a big traditionalist. I'm a big fan of old school, tell the story, take the time to pace out the match type of stuff. Technical wrestling, the Kurt Angles. The Kurt Angles, the Norman Smileys, the I know people are going to give me flack for this, but the crisp end was. The people who will take the time to really pace themselves through a match and throw some solid technique in went for a super kick, instead got a heel kick for his trouble. But and I feel like that pacing has gotten way too fast. It's all about the next spot in wrestling. And I really think that that's not helping the professional wrestling industry as it stands right now. Because I feel like take the Young Bucks, for example. Young Bucks, great workers. But they're spot monkeys. They're all about the spots. They're not telling the story. They're not taking the time to tell a story right. They're not giving the submissions the time. And that was one of the things I really loved about Triple H in his prime, because he knew how to pace out a match. He really knew how to elongate it and make a match worth watching. And I think that's the biggest problem. And I'll give credit to... I know I'm going to get flack for this one too, but I'm going to give credit to John Cena for that too. Because he's still got a very old school storytelling type of deal with him. And I feel like that's really been a lost art in professional wrestling of late. And I'm hoping that with people like the Dudley Boys back, that will help that in tag team wrestling. And, you know, with people, the problem is, A, they're not given the time. They're not given the match time to really tell a good story. And I think that's the biggest problem with the Divas division. One, because Vince is not going to give them the light of day. That's pretty much been cemented with this whole Divas Revolution tank. Say what you will, they're great workers, but it's tanked. And Nikki Bella winning yesterday, or 2 days ago, I'm sorry. Nikki Bella winning 3 days ago, actually. Winning 3 days ago, I'm sorry, I'm doing a recording exam. But Nikki Bella winning cemented that they don't give a crap about this Divas division. They brought three new girls in, said, yeah, Divas Revolution. They had a generally forgettable non-Diva tag match. And then they're not even telling stories. They're not even giving them storylines. Because they care more about Total Divas. And that's really sad. It's sad because those girls, when you saw those matches on NXT, you know they were doing classic storytelling. And that's Triple H's doing. Triple H is classic storytelling, and that's honestly why I love Stardust so much, because he's very old school. He's committed to his craft, and he's committed to his character, which you don't get a lot of nowadays, because all the characters that you see, what a beautiful neckbreaker by Field, but all the characters you see nowadays are just kind of extensions of themselves, which is fine. But I like Stardust because he's got his own character, and he's so devoted to his character. So passionately devoted. And you just don't get that as much because people are just trying to be them and be more. And the thing with Stardust is he's going to add layers onto his character that other wrestlers aren't, and it's going to make them stale. And that's why I'm so hoping that Stardust gets a push. I know that I totally got off track with this, but I got on one of those rants. Cover by Field could be over here. Is Ole out of it? No, only two. But I'm sorry. End tangent. The point is, I'm appreciative that Chesterfield is taking the time to learn the technique and to really old school pace out a match. Here comes a third spinal tap. This could be over for Ole Canoli. If Chester makes a cover here, it's over. Come on, Chester. Make that cover. Chester, no, stop taunting. I need you in the second round. Chester, no! And a low blow by Canoli. And after that was the Chesterfield's third attempt at his finisher, why he didn't go for a cover there is beyond me. And Chesterfield, who's been really taking complete control of this matchup, and a close on by Canoli. Chesterfield has been really dominating this matchup physically, but he has yet to really seal the deal here. Nice leg drop onto the leg of Canoli. And now Canoli slowly fighting back as Chesterfield... Both of these men showing signs of fatigue. Which one of these men will make their way into the second round? Be the last member of the first round to make it into the second. Beautiful hip toss. But Canoli's hurting. And he's hurting bad. And will Chesterfield be able to respond? And now with a headlock. And what's Canoli doing? Spike pile driver. And Canoli starting to build some momentum. After an otherwise one-way first round... Well, the one-way match with Chesterfield Cannoli starting to pick up the pace, and here comes Cannoli Driver! The Cannoli Driver could be over here with the cover. Will Magnitude's man move on? Cover 1, 2, and 3! Damn it, Chester! If you had just made a cover! But didn't take advantage of his opportunities, did Chesterfield, and so your winner, one half of the CIW Tag Team GutCheck Tag Team Champions, Ole Cannoli. And what an amazing matchup, an amazing outing by both of those men. That was a match that ended up being worthy of remembrance, even though I ended up ranting through half of it, which I apologize for, but Ole Cannoli makes his way into the second round, and he will face in the second round Buzz of Joshua Campbell's, or I'm sorry, of the Shadows team. So, your winner, Ole Cannoli, and we are finally done with round one after a match that started with nothing happening. It totally picked up, and I think that was one of the best matches of the first round, I would say. Save for maybe McHugh and Default, I think that was probably the best round one match, but still great nonetheless. And now let's move on to round two. And we're going to start with another member of my team, Tex. I only have two in here. Tex versus Jack Anderson's Eclipse in a one-on-one hardcore match, as all of the matches of round two will be. They will be in the hardcore variety. So everything is legal, no disqualifications, no countouts, pinfall submissions only, referee Lucas just there to ring the bell or call for the submission. And hopefully get hit with something so he actually becomes a better referee. But, in any event, we've had a very eventful first two matches here in GutCheck Episode 6. The first episode, I believe, since early August, when we rebooted, if you will, and came back to GutCheck or something along those lines. It's been a little while. It has been a little while since we've had a GutCheck episode, so it's nice to be back. It's nice to be able to do a whole different brand of people, which I think has actually been really fun to do. It's been creating separate brands and being able to do commentary on separate brands because it's a whole different mode. You're thinking about other people, you're thinking about other stats, and this is a lot less pressure storyline-wise because we've just been doing a tournament. Here comes Eclipse, who had a dominant victory over Ace McAllister in the opening contest of this tournament. Ace McAllister, I think, got one shot in, and Eclipse just totally took him to town. And so will we see that same dominant effort take place here tonight in our main event of CIW GutCheck, the first match of round two. And we are finally slowly making our way towards a winner here. And I'm actually super happy that we even got to this point because, you know, with a tournament, it's difficult because you want to just be done. Like, the first few matches are like, oh, sweet, starting a tournament. Then you get to, like, the middle, and then you're like, oh, more of the tournament. And then finally, you're just like, by the time you get to the semifinals, you're just like, please make this tournament over. But here comes my man, Tex, who attempted to buy CIW. I rejected him, and he decided to just become a professional wrestler instead. Beneficial is the word, not beneficent. That would be if it was also efficient, even though it kind of is, because he is providing us with a little bit of money. He is a rich Texan, so he is providing us with a little bit of money. That's why I put him on the team. You know, the NWO, we need to be, you know, we're off having parties, and we're off, you know, being the NWO. So it's nice to have somebody like Tex there to, you know, fund a lot of those stuffs, fund a lot of those outings, especially the night at the club. We had a great night, probably maybe like 3 weeks ago. Me and the entire Shark Tank, we went out to New York City, and we just wanted to go, like, hang out. We got drunk. Well, some of us got drunk. We didn't all get drunk, because there obviously needs to be a DD, because we decided we don't have the funding to pay for a taxi and get into the club. So, as it turns out, Chesterfield can't drink alcohol, because, he's a teddy bear. And It didn't stop Ted, but it does stop Chesterfield. But anyway, he decided to drive, and whose decision it was to let a teddy bear drive, I'm not gonna say, because it certainly wasn't me. Might have been the Colonial clone, though. By the way, let me tell you how weird that is. Going out to a club with literally your clone, and people asking, hey, are you twins? And I made the mistake of telling a few girls, yeah, he's actually my clone. Clones do not make panties drop, guys. Just letting you know, just say that you're twins. If you happen to come up with a clone, if you happen to make a clone of yourself and take it to the club, do not tell them that it's your clone. Because they're not excited at all. I must have lost like 12 opportunities. But anyway, the point is it was like $300 to get in just to get a table. Just to get a VIP table. But Tex totally covered it. He's like, yeah, I got this. So we all went in. We had a great time. But I did make that mistake of revealing the clone status. And the clone wasn't too happy because it kind of was a buzzkill for both of us. Nice sweeping DDT by Tex. But moving on. Moving right along. And now Tex looks like he's going to go for a leg attack, starting out technically against Eclipse, and taking out the legs of Eclipse, making sure that he can't get that vertical base. Probably one of the smartest decisions that Tex could possibly make, but he's got to stay on it, because Eclipse can easily bounce back very quickly, and with no rules, who knows what's going to happen? Who knows what can happen? A lot can happen in the length of a match, as we saw just in that previous match, where Chesterfield had it going for the majority of the match, but just couldn't capitalize, and therefore Ole Canole made it to the second round. Now, Tex beat James Marks to get here, now biting the forehead of Eclipse, God knows what that's made of or where it's been. And one of these two men will be the first to enter round three, which I don't remember what the stipulation is for it, but I know that I've got it written down somewhere, so we're gonna have to just remember what it is. But I'll tell you, it's not a hardcore. But now, looks like Tex is really getting the advantage here. Double arm DDT, the Tex-Mex, as he calls it. Now, looks like he's going out, and Tex really getting the openings here in the early goings of this matchup, staying on top of Eclipse impressively, and I tried to use that sledgehammer, no dice, as Eclipse now has the sledgehammer, which is not good news for Tex. Tex smartly, I guess, getting a shield in the version of a steel chair and dropping it. Missed and dropped the chair. And, oh, what a Luthez press. And just a series of right hands by Eclipse. And these two men looking to make a statement here. Looking to be the first man to enter the third round. And Eclipse obviously wanting to keep that path of dominance. Oh, God! Oh my God! You know, when I said that I hoped that Luke Goss got hit, I actually did not expect him to get hit. And he just got pelted by that chair. Oh God! Luke Goss is sprawled, leg attack, take a drink. And Luke Goss totally incapacitated. And that was a hell of a chair shot. And Tex tried to get that sledgehammer again, and Eclipse uses it against Tex. This is not boding well for the Shark Tank, and the amusement park is making a dominant effort here. Now Eclipse is really taking control, and it's interesting, and now Lucas finally got up and is starting to accost Eclipse for that chair shot, and a dragon sleeper. Will this be enough to make Tex tap out here? And wouldn't that be an interesting start in a hardcore match? Making your opponent tap out and a punch to the dick. Rude, but with a team name like Abusement Park and Olin, turnabout fair play. Tex not going to have any of that. And that's what I love about Tex. Do what you can to win. I thought it's really interesting that Tex is absolutely ripped. Like, absolutely jacked. And you wouldn't expect that. Honestly, I did not expect that from the rich Texan. I thought that he was going to be like the KFC guy, or like Doug Dimmadome, owner of the Dimmsdale Dimmadome, where he's just like big and huge and like wears a white tuxedo and all that. And oh, another punch to the dick. But instead he comes in the beige. Oh, God! Oh, God! Look at another thunderous chair shot to the skull. Oh, man. And now Tech's just trying everything he can. What a powerbomb! The cover! Luke Goss is completely brain dead after chair shots. And count up to 3, 4, 5. Could count to 40 if he really wanted to. But with no referee, Eclipse bought himself some time there by hitting the referee that all actually saved him, although I don't think Eclipse would have really known that at the time that he hit the crap out of Luke Goss. And Tex trying to come back as much as he possibly can. And both of these two have given each other a fair amount of punishment here. Eclipse seems to be on the better end of the spectrum. And Eclipse getting another chair. And so far, Tex has been 0-for when trying to hit Eclipse with that sledgehammer. I think he should just give it up and go to the chair, go to a barbed wire bat or something. And after that chair shot, the cover by Eclipse could be over here, too, and it is. False count anywhere, and Eclipse took advantage of that, so your winner is Eclipse, who's just punched his ticket into the quarterfinals. The first man to do so in a back-and-forth match that was not as much of a dominating effort as the first go-around was when it comes to Eclipse's matchup. So I am down to my clone as the only member of the Shark Tank left in this tournament, and he's facing, I don't even want to think about it. We'll get there when we reach it, but your winner is Eclipse. Your Al Snow tweet of the day. Put on my workout clothes before going to the donut store just to give the impression. I've read that one before. Okay, so Al Snow doesn't have any new Al Snow tweets of the day, so in any event, your winner is Eclipse, first man into the quarterfinals. My name's The Colonist, and for GutCheck, we will see you next week. Same time, same place. Good night, everybody! Merp.